On this episode, we give our TLC predictions, talk about the Slammys, reveal Lucha Underground, and reveal the winner of the Wrestlemania Bead Sprite Giveaway. Now, on Byte That. Welcome, everybody, to episode 68 of Byte That, the semi-somewhat maybe international professional wrestling podcast, where we talk about the ups and downs of that which we love, which is the Christmas season. You know, Keith has got negative 40 degree Fahrenheit weather. I got beautiful 85 degree weather. It's a great time, people. So we're here with the podcast. Remember, you can check us out every single Tuesday night on iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, and of course, ByteThat.com. My name is Juan Velas. I'm from San Juan, Puerto Rico. And joining me also, all the way from Boston, Massachusetts, Ryan McNulty.
How you doing, Juan? It's like a freaking monsoon out here. It's been pretty crazy with rain, but you know what? At least it's not snow. I'll leave it at that.
Yeah. And the other person that I don't think is having nearly as much of a good time as I am, all the way from the double F for one more week, we got Keith Poshick.
I hate Christmas. I hate everything about Christmas.
So negative 40 degrees is not good?
No, it sucks. Christmas is busy. I'm broke. It's just the worst time of year. If I am the internet wrestling community, Christmas is John Cena to me. Let's put it like that.
Talk about
Let's go mood Christmas.
Killer, man.
Christmas sucks.
Yeah.
Christmas doesn't win on, lol.
You know what doesn't suck, though? At the end of the podcast episode, we'll be announcing the winner of our Byte That Bead Sprite giveaway, so you definitely want to stay tuned to that. But going back a little bit, we got a special event going on this Thursday called TLC. It sort of caught us off guard because there's always this pay-per-view that comes up around, yeah, the Sunday. And a lot of times, you know, Christmas season is a busy time, so it's not necessarily obvious. You know, you got your head on just so many things going on. So we got TLC. We're going to be giving our predictions. But first of all, we got the Slammys. And I don't know, it felt like as we were watching Raw, it was a little bit difficult this week. There was just something. Nothing was really clicking. We were getting really anxious just for the show to end. I want to take it to you first, Mr. McNulty. Just how were you feeling progressively through the show? Was there just nothing that really caught your eye?
Yeah, you know, there was nothing that really stood out to me. I don't know if it's something to do with these 3-week build to pay-per-views, but it's like you would think with 3 weeks that you would try and jam-pack as much excitement to get people going for a pay-per-view as much as possible. But I really just feel like the build has been subpar for a lot of these matches. Nevertheless, I think there's some good matchups there. Just they didn't do a good job of really getting us excited for many of them.
And not only that, but we're also coming off of the whole Vince McMahon interview where he's like basically telling the whole roster to step it up. And if there was a by-the-books Raw, this was pretty much it. It was just nothing stood out. Nothing was special. Nobody really stepped up, quote unquote.
Yeah, I think last week we got the CM Punk interview. There was a part two going on. We got Vince McMahon at a podcast. There was just so many things going on that you're thinking, okay, so we got, you know, the last Raw before TLC. We got some really good matches because, you know, let's clarify this. We're not saying that the matches from TLC are bad. We're actually really looking forward to them as we talk about them, but we expected more. I can't even pinpoint what, but it feels like, you know, if we're talking about talent being hungry, all these things going on, something different should have happened.
I wouldn't even say we expected more. It's just that we expected something, and there was just nothing there.
Now, one thing we do need to get to, obviously, we did get the Slammys, and I want to get to one Slammy Award winner in particular.
Me.
I mean, yeah, from last year. You know, I got to point out, Keith, I'm pretty surprised because last year's award was so outstanding, they didn't even do that this year. We didn't get like a crazy crowd achievement award.
Because nobody could follow up our performance. I am still, by a technicality, a current Slammy winner for another year.
That post-WrestleMania audience effectively killed that category.
I honestly don't blame them, because I felt like the year before there were actually quite a few memorable crowds. This year, I would say maybe just obviously a post-Mania crowd, which wasn't as good as the year before. So there you go, Keith. I'll pat you on the back.
Darn too.
But then maybe was the I think the Hijack Raw, was that this year? That might have been the only other crowd that you might be able to give it to.
But that was still, like, at best. That was like,
I agree.
Raw, like, the only one that comes to mind for me is at the beginning of the year when Daniel Bryan broke away from the Wyatt family and everybody was doing yes in unison. That would be the only thing that came close to one of those big crowd moments. But that was just a segment, not even a whole night.
Yeah, that was like one particular moment. And it wasn't so much organic as it was that moment in the match really... You know, it merited that. It deserved that spot. And last year, we got a lot of those jokey crowds. So remember, we would get the waves. We would get the JBL chants. It's for almost anything. It was almost a weekly thing that eventually we all actually complained about, because it got to the point where it's like, okay, can we please go back to what was in the ring? So do you think anything happened? This isn't really what we were going to talk about, but it's kind of interesting. Was there anything that really happened, or is it just that the product has become a little bit more standard, so people are sort of like, meh, oh, I'll keep watching? What do you think, Keith?
I don't feel right calling it standard, because we're calling a standard product something where Sting is now a member of the roster, the streak has ended, and the title isn't anywhere to be found. It's not standard, but I would say different, perhaps not for the best.
Yeah, I mean, with the crowds, I think there was... You know, there were good crowds, of course, you know, that they're popping for guys and great reactions and stuff. There just wasn't any crowds that kind of took a life of their own as much recently. But sometimes that's actually for the better, because like you said, Juan, there were times where it was getting a little ridiculous, where the crowd was not even caring about the show and just trying to amuse themselves. You know, it works for a post-Mania Raw here and again, but even they would react to some good things like Ziggler winning the title, etc. But I'm kind of glad that it's kind of gone away from the crowd just trying to be about themselves.
Mm-hmm. I think the prime example that we're trying to hit is the CM Punk chant. It like defines this whole issue. Like, people are like rebelling against the WWE by saying CM Punk just for the sake of saying it.
And it's funny, because if you think about that chant and just overall people trying to effectively interrupt the show, because say, you know, whoever's out there, AJ Lee, people want to support AJ Lee, yet when she's out there, they chant CM Punk. Mm-hmm. How many people actually ask themselves, gee, does that help her? Or are we saying almost we care so little about AJ Lee, we got to chant about her husband? And this isn't the only situation. Now, there are just so many times where the crowd tries to interrupt, and it's like, guess what? You could do so much more by chanting for who you want. Case in point, Daniel Bryan. We had that exact same situation where people were supporting him, and it got to a point where they had to do something, because the crowd, you know, when John Cena had to pull him from a group of wrestlers to just be like, yeah, he's here. The chant's so loud, the segment was literally interrupted.
Well, it's funny you mentioned that, because WWE calendar-wise, a year ago was that whole championship ascension ceremony where they literally had to stop the segment because they were chanting for Daniel Bryan. So if you want to hijack the show, there's a right way to do it, and that would be a prime example of that.
Exactly, and that is somebody that people really did a good job building. The people were really caring about Daniel Bryan. Now, unfortunately, Daniel Bryan was not in action very much for this year. He was only in action for pretty much till WrestleMania. Well, let's round it up, because maybe something happened afterwards, but the fact of the matter is WrestleMania was really the big moment. And after that, we've gotten all the injury stuff. So when the Superstar of the Year Slammy nomination came out, we saw a lot of people that were very deserving. However, there was somebody in that list that we completely wrote out. Like, there was no way they were going to choose that person, whether it be a fixed voting, whether people legitimately voted for this guy. Lo and behold, Roman Reigns becomes this year's Superstar of the Year. I got to say quickly, I am completely... not okay with that. I don't necessarily agree with it, just because I think like so many other things have happened right now, and Roman Reigns, who's been injured kind of like Daniel Bryan, but he's been the least organic guy compared to everybody else. So I want to get your reactions. Am I alone in this? Do you guys agree? What's up?
I think we did say something where we're going to think basically the category was a complete joke if Roman Reigns won. And sure enough, he wins it. Now they say it was, you know, they actually go by, the fan vote for a lot of these, or all of them. But I really think that this wasn't the case here, because just judging by the fact that Match of the Year, the Survivor Series elimination tag match, which was great. But obviously that was something that was in a lot of people's recent memory, so there's a good chance that's why it won. Not that it didn't deserve it, but, you know, arguments could be made. But Roman Reigns is a guy who's been out on injury for a couple of months now. It's like, do you really think the fans would actually vote for Reigns, a guy who, you know, he broke out of the Shield in the summer, had, you know, a couple months of a run, and then was out? He has been out for like 2.5 months now. I really think this is obviously WWE just trying to give him a little bit of a boost right before he comes back.
It's the crazy part is he beat out Seth Rollins and Dean Ambrose, both his Shield brethren, to win that award, who can arguably, you can say, had way better years than Roman. But it just felt like some tool, like, hey, Roman's going to be back soon. Don't forget about him. He's going to be the next big company guy. And now this is just another bullet point we can add to his list.
Now, obviously, we got to play devil's advocate. We're saying this as if it's a fact. It just seems it just seems so weird. Yeah, like when you got a guy like Dean Ambrose, who has really had to step up his game more than almost anybody else, because Seth Rollins, he had the whole authority situation. But then you bring up guys like Dean Ambrose, who a couple of people were worried. Okay, so what are they going to do post-Shield? Then we see, like, yeah, he's been amazing post-Shield. Everybody has, even Reigns to a point. But to that level, we actually got a tweet from James Lemmy, I want to say. And he said another sign that they are pushing Roman, though they've been doing that for 2 years now. He's no real superstar. He's just what the WWE wants to feed us. I want to bring this to everybody listening, because obviously, we represent a certain amount of the community. You know, we like a certain superstars if you listen to the weekly show. So are you happy? You that are listening, are you happy that Roman Reigns won? Because I am legitimately curious about this. Are you guys curious about this? What if, hypothetically, he legitimately won? Would that surprise you? And if so, why?
He did win.
No, but I mean, like, let me clarify. It's because I'm a little sick. But say hypothetically, he legitimately won because the people voted for him. Nothing to do with WWE. Nothing would fix voting. He legitimately beat guys like Seth Rollins and Dean Ambrose.
What does that say about the audience?
Why would that surprise you, if it even would? If we got legitimate confirmation that, hey, yeah, people voted for him, despite everything that we're saying right now.
Well, I'll give my 2 cents. That would actually be a big surprise, because like I said, if you look at some of the other awards, it seems to be that the things that are more fresh in people's minds is what won. So I would assume someone who's been on TV and done something bigger more recently would have won. If it legitimately was the people, then I think that would give more credence to them pushing Reigns as hard as they do.
My counterpoint would be, normally don't they show like poll numbers for Superstar of the Year and this stuff?
I don't think they don't for Slammys.
No?
No, they do for stuff like, what match type is it going to be? A count-out match? No.
Oh, okay.
You know, that type of stuff, yeah. We get voting for that. So, yeah, let me know. I'm really curious about that. So, with that being said, I think it's time we get to our TLC predictions, because
that's how memorable Raw was.
There were a couple other Slammys. There were other things sort of going on. But let's be honest, this was very much a way just showing everybody that it's going to be on Sunday. So might as well talk about Sunday, right?
Sure.
So getting first to what I believe is the pre-show match, we got The New Day. And I actually want to take give you 60 seconds apiece to really get your reactions on the New Day now that we've been exposed to them. So, Mr. McNulty, you got 60 seconds, and I am actually timing it as opposed to, not opposed, but 3, 2, 1.
All right, well, my opinion on the New Day is pretty simple. It's a big disappointment. I really thought they were going to break out and really be just something against the grain of the typical kind of dancing gimmick, like fun dance thing. But it's really just like every other fun dance thing, and I want it to be proven wrong. And I hope it evolves into something better, but right now, it's just not, I don't like it.
Did good, kid. 29.12. So, Keith,
I won't even need that. In order to maintain the balance of the wrestling world, there must always be a 3MB. When one 3MB falls, a new day begins. And that's my take on the New Day.
Wow. Okay, can that be the tweet of the week?
Sure.
No, just taking my reaction to them, I have no idea what the hell to make of it, because I'm trying really hard not to say, yeah, they're stereotype stable, but if they're not that, I don't know what the hell they are, really. So, New Day, I don't know what's going on. I don't know what's going on with the team that they're going up against, actually, with Golden Stardust at TLC. That's the tag team match that's going to be happening. These guys have not really done much else ever since they became brothers that became champions. So, Ryan, taking it to you first, who's going to come out the winner?
Well, looks like a New Day is on the rise and Goldust and Stardust are on the downtrend. So I'm going to go with the New Day, even though, like Keith pointed out while we were watching Raw, that they jobbed on their first Raw appearance. So things weren't starting out too great for them, already getting into that 3MB, spot. But I still think they're going to win here.
To be fair, though, wasn't like the team they beat Gold and Stardust during that match?
Yes.
So
that would be correct.
So by law of that, I have to go with the New Day.
You know what? I'm actually going to agree to, because I think that if at any point they're going to start teasing this Gold Stardust thing where they're going to split up, maybe we'll be seeing Cody Rhodes again, because let's be honest, what else are they going to do with Stardust right now? If they're not going to push him to the top, might as well have a little bit of fun with his brother. That doesn't sound right. So, moving on to the next match. We got Swaggy Time, Jack Swagger, taking on Rusev. This has been a America feud going on. So, we got this match happening. Mr. McNulty, who comes out the winner?
Well, welcome to the ultimate treading water feud of all time, where Rusev's already recycling opponents less than a year in. This is just ridiculous that they're even doing this, but Rusev's gonna win. Why, if Swagger lost at SummerSlam or Money in the Bank, wherever it was, what makes you think he's gonna win now? I mean, Swagger hasn't really done anything since then, and they've just been building Rusev up more and more. So this is really just a complete waste of time, because they want to save opponents for, you know, bigger events like the Rumble and WrestleMania for Rusev. So he's just kind of fighting Swagger again. So Rusev, 100%.
I think the words treading water could not describe it more perfectly. It's a holdover until next month, basically. And if anybody thinks Jack Swagger is going to win, please let me know, because I'd really like to dissect your brain.
Hey, there is that one listener who's a big fan of Jack Swagger. So
I love how we always got to go back to that yeah. guy. You know, you man, specifically you.
I forget your name, but I'm sorry, man. Just if you're a fan of Jack
you're
Swagger,
you're the people. Truly,
if you're a fan
the people.
Of Jack Swagger, you're gonna have a bad time.
Confirmed, and I agree. Yeah, I don't think anything else needs to be said other than usually at the end of the year we get somewhat of an indication of what's going to be happening early next year. So I'm thinking maybe clean sweep against Swagger. Somebody comes out the end, and we know like it could be a big challenge. Who knows? Maybe it could even be Reigns. He doesn't need to be clear to wrestle. They can just tease something like that. So moving on to the Divas Championship match, we have Nikki Bella being accompanied by Brie, which that still gives me a really bad headache.
As to
just how I don't. Yeah, it's that's a topic for another day. She's taking on AJ Lee, Keith, who wins?
I'm going to go with Nikki Bella. I don't know why, but Nikki Bella seems like a good idea. I don't know. I just don't care about this match. The Divas division has almost gone full circle at this point, where it's back to not caring. So, yeah.
For this match, I'm also going with Nikki Bella. It really seems like there's no particular reason to switch the belt back. My only really hopes for this match is that they actually give it time this time around, because apparently they were supposed to have a longer match, and it got cut short, so they had to do the whole kiss of death angle. So hopefully they get their proper matchup, and Nikki Bella's probably going to win, but I'm looking forward to it.
I agree 100%. I think Nikki Bella's going to come out the winner. Just a quick note, if you go to Squirt Circle on Reddit, check out the post that compares the Divas division to getting an English major. And I think that's a really good indication of what's happening right now with the Divas division. Because quick note, when they completely drop this Brie Bella storyline, not even make reference to it because they don't even keep teasing. It's just like, that. This is what's happening. And you keep going. I think that's a big issue. So I think it's just going to be Nikki Bella till we move on to bigger, better things. Moving on to this match that I know just Ryan loves so much, the name of this match. No. We got a stairs match, okay? Stairs, because it's TLCS. We got Eric Rowan, plural. Big Red, because it keeps getting better. Stairs match between Big Red and The Big Show. Huh, get it? Ryan, who wins?
This is actually a really tough one because, obviously they want to push Rowan, and I never thought I'd say that, but at the same time, like, the whole effect of sometimes losing, you look better than just running over everybody in your path. So I'm actually going to go with the Big Show winning here, but it's going to be a good loss for Eric Rowan. Like, he's going to put up a big fight. He's going to win the crowd over, but he's not going to win the match. Stairs match, we've never had it before. There might be a reason why, but I'm going to keep my mind open because I want to be wrong about this. I want this to be good.
So what is a stairs match? Is it just the stairs are legal and nothing else is?
That'd be horrible. So it's like you grab a chair.
Not the stairs.
Stairs. And it's got to be those. It can't be like,
maybe it's like when you're a kid and you race to the top of the stairs. Whoever makes it to the top but first. Like, in that case, definitely Eric Rowan.
But a ladder is technically stairs that lead to nowhere. So are they legal?
Well, they're called rungs, aren't they? Not steps. So it's not exactly stairs.
Somewhat maybe. Furniture podcast.
Indeed. No, but I'm going with Eric Rowan just because I would like to see him, for all the reasons Ryan said, I would like to agree with that, plus add a win to Eric Rowan. I'd like to see Rowan be built up more and more and more, and then maybe potential with a big match / feud with Luke Harper later on.
And also, I'm looking forward to next year's The Floor is Lava match.
Please, can that be in WWE 2K16 with more features? Please, thank you. Can we have a tag team titles match with arguably one of the most over stuntmen in history? We got Damian Mizdow, The Miz, the tag champs, taking on the Usos.
Hold on, who are you picking for Rowan? You never said.
All right. No, I love how I wrote my prediction, but I didn't actually say it. I think it's going to be a big show.
One job.
It's going to be this type of match where it's really hard to keep Rowan down. Like, Big Show's going to keep pummeling with the stairs and all that stuff. Maybe even kick out of a punch just for the sake of demonstrating just how strong Rowan is. But effectively, he's going to get punched again, and then Big Show's going to get the victory.
I got faith in you, Goatman. We can do this, buddy.
Yeah, we finally got it. We got a little bit of controversy, a little bit of difference here going on. So moving on to the tag match, we have the situation with the Usos, Naomi, The Miz, sort of, maybe persuading Naomi, making a move on her, million-dollar moves. So, Mr. McNulty, new champions or still champions?
I'm going with Mizdow, The Miz and Damian Mizdow here. You get to stick with basically the hottest thing going right now. And yeah, there's no reason to cut this off. I really want them to keep the titles. I really want to see Mizdow retain his toy championships. So yeah, and I hope they keep progressing this whole Naomi storyline, because you know what? They're adding elements to this thing, and I'm really digging it. And I say that every week, but I am.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's going to be some sort of finish where Naomi ends up costing the Usos the match, and that's how Mizdow wins. But I'm going with Mizdow on this one.
I agree, too. And just a quick thought, I want to see them keeping the tag titles all the way to just before WrestleMania. Then we get Damian Mizdow versus Miz at WrestleMania. Calling it right now, December 9th, 2014. Moving on to the chairs match, we have the Ryback taking on the Kane. So we're moving to more traditional matches here. It's still a little weird. It's still only chairs. And given the fact that you can't hit people with...
So what
it's just a stairs, chairs to the back match, I think we can really specify.
So what happens if you throw somebody against the steel steps in this match? Is it a disqualification because now there's a stairs match?
Keith, you're overthinking wrestling too much. Calm down. Calm down, buddy. Doing all good. Right.
You can good? Get through this.
Okay. Having said that, who do you think is going to win?
The Ryback, probably. No, I don't know what else to say. It's probably going to be the Ryback.
Probably, yeah. Because why not, right? Because
why Kane? That's the better question.
Okay, so Ryan, why is Ryback winning?
He's going to win because he's going to hit the Kane with the chair, basically. It's a chairs match, and it's either going to go one of two ways. One, they're going to use other weapons and nobody's going to care, or two, they're just going to conveniently only use chairs for whatever reason. But Ryback's going to win. There's absolutely no reason for Kane to win.
Ryan's pretty much said anything I can, so yeah, I agree. Ryback. Now, finally getting to matches we've sort of seen legitimately happen. We have a ladder match between the IC champion and Dolph Ziggler. So is the Herb, Luke Harper, going? I'm sorry. I wanted to say that for like a month now. Leave me alone. So is he going to retain the championship or not?
First of all, I'd like to say that I'm so excited to see how Luke Harper does in a ladder match. Like, it could be the best thing ever, or it could be the worst thing ever. There's only one way to find out, and that's by tuning into TLC on Sunday. But I'm going to go with Luke Harper on this one. I'd like to see them keep the IC title on Luke Harper, and maybe that could be something for him and Eric Rowan to feud with, like I mentioned earlier. So I'm going with the Herp on this one.
It's funny you guys call him that. I'll give a shout out to my roommate, Ryan Buckley, because we were watching Royal Rumble last year, and he mispronounced Luke Harper's name and called him Luke Herper. So we made a joke.
Completely
Luke,
different gimmick.
Yes. So we've always found that pretty funny. We had Luke Herper, and then we had Eric Derper. But on this one, I'm going to go with Harper retaining, just simply by the fact that he's still kind of a fresh IC champ, but definitely match of the night, I'm easily thinking. Because I really like the dynamic of Harper just being a big guy, but, you know, he can dive out of the ring, he can pull off some high-flying stuff, and you know Ziggler's going to pull out all the stops in a ladder match. This should be insane, and I'm looking forward to it a lot.
I just have this image in my head of Luke Harper climbing a ladder, and it's my favorite image ever.
Honestly, it's going to be interesting how they play these three matches out, because they have three legitimate match of the night contenders. We got this and then the other two matches that we got to get to. Yeah, I think Harper's going to win. It's an interesting spot because they're making Dolph almost be like the next D-Bry in the way that he's like the next good guy that the people are really getting over. But he's in the IC title scenario. How often do we see that? You know, we usually see guys in the world championship situation being up there, but obviously there's no champion, so I guess the IC title's the next best thing. I think Luke Harper's going to win. Now, getting to the name of the show, we got a TLC match between Bray Wyatt and Dean Ambrose. This is going to be awesome, regardless of who wins. I just want to get that out of the way. Keith, who wins?
This is a really tough one. I honestly don't know. I'm going to go with I don't know. Can I put a question mark beside mine? Do I have to choose?
Because don't cop out, man.
There's such a good argument for both of them winning, and I know we say this every single time, but this could be the match that actually has a finish, a definitive finish. So
please.
Yes, please at this point. Like, it's great. I could see these guys wrestle each other till 2022, but just let one of them win a match at this point. So if I have to choose somebody, I'm going to go with Bray Wyatt on this one.
That face of yours was still like,
I don't know. It's Bray Wyatt, it still doesn't feel right, because it could be Ambrose, but it could be Wyatt. I don't know.
Well, you'll have to wait till Sunday to find out, sir. What do you think, Ryan?
Is this just a pinfall TLC?
I'm assuming so, because what are they going to grab? A mask?
Has there ever been a pinfall TLC?
There was recently.
In SmackDown versus Raw
2006. Yeah, no, there was a pinfall TLC.
The six-man tag
one. So it looks like that's going to be another pinfall TLC, unless they want to hang something weird like Sister Abigail or whatever. But
Judy Bagwell.
I'm going with as you smarkily wrote on the little program here, John Moxley. Oh wait, no, I'm not going with John Moxley. I take that back. I'm going with Bray Wyatt because my argument is that I really just don't think they're ever going to let Dean Ambrose win a pay-per-view match ever. So I'm going with Bray Wyatt on this one.
You know what? I'm actually going to go the other route. I think Dean Ambrose is going to get that win because he needs that win.
He's getting
to the point. Keith, when you come out of an ambulance and you either farted so bad to the point where smoke comes out, or just, you know, it has that emotion, you know that you're bound to win a match. It's just logic. It's going to happen.
Well, does he need Ryback last year?
Yeah, that went so well for him. But does he really need that win more than Bray Wyatt, though? Because Ambrose continues to be Ambrose, win, lose, or draw. But Bray Wyatt's just kind of, he's this big guy that can't get the job done.
Is it just me, though, or even though this feud should be, like, amazing and everything, I can't help but feel, and let me know if you guys feel the same way, that both of the momentum of these guys has kind of, like, fallen off. Does it feel that way?
I don't think it's so much fallen off. Taking it to you, Keith, I'm actually going to transition that question. Do you think it's a situation of they're sort of just letting them have their own thing? Because it seems like they are.
I think so, but at the same time, it feels like they're just like plucking at hairs, trying to find a reason why this feud is existing. Like 2 weeks ago, Dean Ambrose broke a chair, so Bray Wyatt broke Dean Ambrose and sent him to the hospital. It just feels like there's not a lot of like overall continuity.
Shouldn't it be the hottest thing going right now?
It totally should.
Yeah,
but
definitely.
It's completely not, and I think that's a problem. I feel like a month and a half ago, Dean Ambrose was, you know, he was getting white hot. And then after that Hell in a Cell match, you know, he was supposed to just directly transition to Bray Wyatt. But it's just like, I feel like the crowd kind of died down on him a little bit, and people aren't as high on him right now. I just feel like they needed more. I feel like they get like one segment a week and it's just not enough.
Somebody needs a win. That's what it comes down
to. That would help.
I think the best way to put it, if you guys haven't listened to the, Talk is Jericho episode with Seth Rollins, do yourself a favor, check that out. At one point he talks about the fact that you don't always get the match of the night. You don't always get the spot. You know, everything can't be a five-star thing because you can sort of take something away from something else. I'm not necessarily agreeing with that, but I think that they definitely want that focus to be on Seth Rollins, John Cena maybe. So they're having that feud go on, but just like on the side. Like if people happen to react to it, that's cool. They got their TLC match. So it's like, it's technically the biggest match because it's the TLC match, not just the tables match, but it's not the main focus, even though it's the name of the show.
On a little side note, a little tidbit, I actually found out what Follow the Buzzards means.
Huh, really?
Yes. Bray Wyatt revealed it in part two of his interview with Stone Cold. And I mean, it's pretty obvious when you think about it and actually put it together, but basically, you know, buzzards or whatever are where dead things are. So, you know, you follow where the dead things are, and there's Bray Wyatt.
Well, people, we learned something new today. And that's Vince Ryan's
fact of the learn week. Of the,
yeah.
Fact of the week.
Getting to the main event now. We got a tables match between Seth Rollins and John Cena. So this is a tables match. We're taking them ladders and chairs out of the equation. Keith, who wins?
Dear Lord in heaven, hallowed be thy name. May Seth Rollins win this tables match. You've set up a predicament where Cena can lose and still not look that weak, like he can lose by a fluke. And if Seth Rollins wins, we take away the Brock Lesnar versus John Cena 3 match. And please, 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 one thing this year, Lord, just please.
Did that sound like a song to anybody else? Like,
well, Ryan? I started out with the Lord's Prayer and then went into wrestling.
It's only fitting. So you said please, but you didn't say, you said you want Rollins to win.
Yes.
Now, whether you think he is going to win.
I think he's going to win because I don't think there's a reason to see Brock Lesnar, John Cena 3. And this is their out, so I think they're going to take it.
What do you think, Ryan?
All right. So you can put over what is basically the top heel in the company. And you can get Cena, you can write Cena out of having to do Lesnar versus Cena 3. I think this makes way too much sense. So Cena wins, lol.
Ah, a fair point. So that's a good one.
I just can't help but feel that there's no reason for him to win. So Cena's going to win.
Yeah, it makes way too much sense that they're going to avoid that match happen. But at the same time, okay, so Rollins wins. So it's Rollins Lesnar. That sounds really weird. So I legitimately do not like to point out that I think Cena's going to win.
But it's not set in stone that it's going to be Rollins Lesnar. They've been saying if Rollins wins, there's going to be a new number one contender. Now, if only there's a match next month that places 30 people in a match to look for a number one contender.
Well, based on that, I think that maybe Seth Rollins is going to win. So I'm actually going to change my pick. But that doesn't mean that Cena can't then go in the Rumble and still have that match with Lesnar.
No, oh, that's, I just got a hand. No, don't even whoa, say that. That's got, not. No. No.
Yeah, you know what?
If we get another Cena redemption year at WrestleMania,
I'm just, out. I'm oof. Done. Yeah.
Bye, folks. It's been,
by
it's
that,
been real.
2013, 2015. 2013-2015. Having said that, I believe it's time for a little break with something we call
Tweet of the Week! Tweet of the Week!
That's right. Take a break, eat a Kit Kat, shoot some money, because it's Tweet of the Week time. Now, this week's Tweet of the Week is brought to you by Wrestling Memes. At Wrestling Memes on Twitter. It's a very funny Twitter account. If you don't follow it, I can only give it my and Juan and Ryan's highest recommendations. This week's Tweet of the Week is coming in 2015, live on pay-per-view. Tables, ladders, chairs, stairs, Care Bears, pears, Ric Flairs, and shares.
Wow. Ric Flair's was definitely the best part about that.
Yeah. Oh, man, that headache is just getting way worse. But yeah. Thank you, Keith, for that beautiful Tweet of the Week. Remember, you can follow us on Twitter, also on Facebook, by searching Byte That Cast. Remember to check out our YouTube channel, where we have the podcast hosted every single Tuesday. And, you know, usually the podcast, we put a very nice graphic with the show topics and, you know, the timestamps. But starting next week, for 2 weeks, we got Ryan is coming over to Puerto Rico for my wedding. I get married on the 20th. And we are going to be doing a double dose, if you will, edition of a video Byte That Cast. So you definitely want to stick around. We're going to have some people join us live from a bedroom audience. Can't wait for that. So remember to also stay tuned for the bottom portion of the podcast where we reveal the winner of the Byte That giveaway. And, you know, we also got our special videos happening every now and then. And next week, we're going to be talking about NXT TakeOver, maybe. That's coming up this Thursday. Check that out. Now, we got so many podcast things happening. It is ridiculous how almost the primary topics of our podcast are coming from podcasts. This is something that Mr. McNulty actually brought up in the Steve Austin Show, Working Man's podcast. He was talking about the fact that he was a big fan of Cesaro. And then when they were discussing a couple of things, Cesaro revealed to him that heel moves or traditional heel tactics from the past are actually banned, to which Stone Cold got legitimately upset. So since you brought this up, Ryan, I actually want to take it to you and ask you, is the basic classic cheap heel really gone? And then we are left with either sort of a cowardly heel and a cocky heel, which is what's sort of happening right now?
Yeah, and I really just look at it as only kind of limiting things. And to sort of support this with what Cesaro was saying, where a lot of these cheap moves, you know, like eye pokes and, you know, taking off the top turnbuckle, you really just don't see it a lot anymore. And I was also listening to Jericho's podcast from a couple weeks ago about what is known as the Brazilian flag incident, where, he was in Brazil and he ended up kicking the flag because he was a heel at the time when he was feuding with Punk. And apparently that's a felony in Brazil. But anyway, when he was being scolded by Vince, you know, Jericho's trying to say, you know, I'm just trying to be a heel. And Vince was like, we don't do that 80s BS anymore. Kind of supporting the fact they don't like a lot of this cheap heel stuff. But at the same time, it's like, you know, now the crowd just really likes the heels because they kind of act different. And I think it doesn't hurt to have a couple of guys doing these cheap heel moves, because otherwise you're just limiting yourself and you're putting people into only certain molds and things like that.
It only like enables a certain space for things to grow, because you're almost limiting a whole portion of character development for a heel by eliminating this completely. But what I was thinking to myself while you were saying that is, maybe it's only eliminated for certain people, because think about Randy Orton's heel run with the Authority. He was basically the cowardly heel that whole time, always hiding behind the Authority and that kind of stuff.
But what about, I'm talking strictly moves in the ring that are heel-like moves.
Like low blows are pretty much gone.
Yeah, that's true.
Or just dragging their face across Rick
Flair's
the rope.
Move set is banned, basically.
Yes. Essentially, you really just don't see a lot of those heel moves, or even just distracting the referee for a second just to get one move in that, you know, you'll see that every once in a while, but it's literally only for the finish of a match. You'll never see someone just sneaking in a few moves behind the ref's back nearly as much anymore.
That's true.
Yeah, and it leads to situations kind of like Bray Wyatt versus Dean Ambrose. Basically, that feud comes down to badass guy versus badass guy, which is in no means bad ass.
Well, it is.
Yeah, like it's actually good, but how much better would it be if we could legitimately hate Bray Wyatt? If he could go to the deepest, darkest corner of his mind, I botched that, damn it. And like really got us to hate him to the point where we love Ambrose more. And maybe that would sort of clarify that situation that I can't talk. I'm too sick, man. But that situation where maybe the people aren't popping as much for Dean Ambrose, that could really help.
Basically, it also just helps to have these heel type moves for especially new viewers. Because if someone just flipping through channels and they see a match and they stop for a second, obviously, right from the get-go, they don't know exactly who to cheer for. But if you see one guy cheating and doing all that crap, you know, maybe you're going to start cheering for the other guy. But if you just see two guys kind of doing the same moves, you're not really invested in either of them.
Exactly. And I think it's Yeah, it brings up not just the cheap tactics, actually, if anything. Wrestling matches have gone down to almost just punches, kicks, suplexes. There's not a lot more variety. And partly that could be because of the whole, you know, injury stuff. But that also makes it a lot more challenging.
To go back to that whole casual viewer just flipping the channels, like, they won't know all of this character development. So how are they supposed to know that, like, Bray Wyatt and Dean Ambrose are two badasses? It's just a weird guy with bug eyes coming out of an ambulance filled with smoke to like the casual viewer. So the nice thing about having those like dirty heel tactics that are moves, it sets a ground baseline a lot faster. And maybe that's a lost art at this point.
A lot of good discussion. We got to break it down in the future, just like specific characters that just cannot work in 2014. I think Ric Flair, oddly enough, is a good example.
Now, I want to ask you guys, why do you think Vince doesn't like it? Do you think he just thinks it's basically indie and archaic or anything? And we're above that now? What do you guys think?
Probably that he just wants to get away from traditional wrestling as much as possible. Because, like, to see how fast he reacts when somebody says wrestling and he's like, nope, we're sports entertainment, damn it. And then just to get away from all of that. So he sees the old 80s BS quote as more wrestling than sports entertainment. So he wants to build his own thing.
And I think Jericho, oddly enough, is his own demise. Think about the last time Jericho was here wearing the suit. We saw videos of him basically punching a woman, people throwing stuff at him. A lot of controversy because his character was this. And this is still during like the PG era, basically. But things like that, maybe WWE wants to avoid. Obviously, that doesn't make the company look good. It doesn't make anybody look good. When CM Punk was heel, you know, he also talked about a guy's face looking like a certain thing and all these things. So it's an interesting situation because even though it makes you hate the character, from a company standpoint, I can totally see why they would want to avoid that. So taking it to everybody listening, I would actually like to know, do you miss those type of characters, or are you actually glad that we don't have that type of controversial situation anymore?
And that being said, you totally just reminded me that CM Punk faked having a heart attack when a guy who had a real heart attack came back, so.
Yeah, but think about it took CM Punk to get that to happen.
No, you really just opened my mind to the fact that it's PR, man. It's friggin' yeah. PR, public relations. If they do anything to heel, it comes back to bite them. They get negative press. And that's just stupid.
Yeah, because think about it. In a movie, if somebody dies or something, it gets great PR. Oh, the movie's amazing. That murder scene, if that happens in wrestling, it's like, they buried that man in cement.
Well, even think about a few weeks ago when Rusev pulled down the flag. Didn't that become a big thing?
No, you know what became a big thing? And I was actually just thinking of that, too. When Vince is all like, oh, you know, that's 80s BS to Jericho. Then they have Big Show rip down the Russian flag. Like, what the hell is that? You know, so it's totally hypocritical now that I think about it.
Yeah, because we even brought it up in the podcast. Like, did you not actually expect that to happen? So maybe it's better to ask for forgiveness than, you know, for an opportunity for to get that to happen. Yeah. But it's weird because those little things get that type of press. Imagine that type of character being there, like Stone Cold or something. So, yeah, I actually want to get that back. You know, let's give it a couple more months, see what's happening, and definitely bring that up. Now, we primarily talk about WWE in this podcast. However, I actually want to dedicate a couple of minutes to something called Lucha Underground, because we talk about Ring of Honor, TNA, PWG, Shimmer, all these wrestling companies around the world. Lucha Underground has taken the wrestling universe by storm. If you haven't watched it, do yourself a favor. Look at El Rey Network. They got a couple of clips or even full matches in their YouTube account. Look up Lucha Underground, El Rey Network. This thing is awesome. I got Keith to check it out, and I actually want to get his immediate reaction because he's fairly into the series. It's less than 8 episodes in right now, so you still have a lot of time to catch up. Each episode is around an hour long. What do you think about it, Keith?
If I could describe it in one word, it would be refreshing. It just feels so refreshing. Like, it's not the same old storyline. It's I don't know. It's just so different. Like, there's the head guy and he's obviously corrupt and he throws around money everywhere. And the feel of it is just so like grungy and backwater. It's so awesome.
Yeah. And for a quick context, yeah, the premise of this is that they take the greatest luchadors. They try to avoid seeing wrestlers. The show is commentated by a wrestling legend, you could say, Vampiro and Matt Stryker. You got guys like Chavo Guerrero, Prince Puma. You got Sexy Star, because it's a little bit controversial. You actually see female wrestlers taking on male wrestlers. So for people that have only watched WWE, that may be a bit of a shock to see legitimate violence basically between male and female, but just the atmosphere,
it's the best,
of Lucha Underground. Yeah, and like I want to get your reaction, because the segments are like a movie. They're like a TV series with different camera angles. It's very, very well produced.
But not only that, one of the things that really stuck out to me is because it's episodic, where one episode ends, another one begins, at least from what I've seen. So there's like an ongoing thing. Like a couple weeks ago, we talked about how WWE can feel more like an actual TV series, like a Game of Thrones. And I think Lucha Underground seriously hits that, and it hits it right on the mark.
Yeah, because it goes as far, we actually start with, you know, like LA, because it's filmed out of the temple, which is basically a sound studio in LA. But we get to see like the executive producers. We get to see the fact that Chavo is a producer in the show. So you get the full credits as if it were a TV series, yet it's a wrestling show with that TV series vibe to it. I think it is the perfect example of you can do the exact same thing differently in wrestling, and it feels brand new. Because, yeah, we talked about the Authority. They were a corrupt team. We got Dario Cueto here, who is a corrupt owner, but the way it's filmed, like, his office is, like, right next to the ring, technically, so he can come out whenever he wants. He can just buy new people. Picture, like, Million Dollar Man, but, like, Latino and badass.
And not just that, like, the vignettes, they're so awesome. Like when they're debuting somebody, I mentioned to you, like you could put Batman in one of those vignettes and it would be just as awesome. It's just like 2 minutes of somebody explaining themselves and just doing like their big moves, and it just looks awesome. And the whole feel of it's like this smoky back room. Like you see the owner having like a conversation with Conan over a cigar, talking about like, I got a guy for you. Yeah, he's going to come in and break everything. Yeah, it's just the best.
Now, as I mentioned, this is very different for people that have only watched WWE. This could be a Ryan McNulty. This could be anybody that maybe, you know, they've seen a little bit of other wrestling, but the majority of our exposure is to WWE. What would you say, or how would you prepare somebody in order for them to enjoy Lucha Underground, which, you know, is a little bit more spotty? You know, there are more moves, there are more kickouts. What would you really advise for them in order to get more enjoyment out of the show?
I would just say go in expecting, take everything that you've learned about wrestling and then turn it on its head, because Lucha Underground is not that. It's a breath of fresh air. Like if you've ever said like, oh, this is getting stale, this is starting to feel like really boring, you should go watch Lucha Underground, because it's the opposite of everything wrestling.
Yeah, to summarize, if you enjoy wrestling, if you enjoy TV shows, like episodic TV shows, you got to check it out. Ryan, I would love for you to check it out. You are going to be in Puerto Rico next week, so
you don't got much of a choice.
Yeah. You got to watch it.
After hearing your explanations, you actually have really intrigued me. And I think it's exactly like what we talked about before, that maybe this is the hybrid of wrestling and episodic like TV that really needs to happen. So you've definitely caught my interest. So I will be checking it out.
Just a quick note. The first 10 minutes I know are a little bit out there. I don't think that with the first episodes, like 10 minutes is the best way to introduce people to the show, because they go like with Aztec history and all that stuff. Just watch it. Just think like this is a TV show. This is not a wrestling product. This is not sports entertainment. This is a TV show that happens to have a wrestling ring.
Just think about it this way. Have you ever had a TV show where you said, yeah, you really got to check this out? Just sit through the first couple episodes. They're all right. But then it gets really good. That's the best way to describe Lucha.
Actually, I would say, like, just skip the first 10 minutes, and it's, like, amazing. Like, I'm into episode 4 and 5 so far, and each episode is better than the last. The crowd is awesome. Vampiro's awesome. Matt Stryker's commentary I've been a very big fan of. So, seriously, do yourself a favor. Check out Lucha Underground. And if you have, let us know what you think by leaving a comment on YouTube or by sending us a tweet over at Byte That Cast. Now, Ryan.
Mm-hmm.
We had a giveaway, right?
We did, yes.
Yeah, I'm going to need a little bit of help. Do you mind helping me out here?
I'll try. I will try.
Okay, now I don't want to do drum roll. I want to actually bring it back to, can I get a brop-a-doo as we reveal the winner of the Bite That Beat Sprite giveaway?
I need to swig a water for the working man real quick.
All right.
Build it up. Ladies and gentlemen, so the winner of the 2014 Byte That Wrestling Podcast Beat Sprite giveaway is Gene Demand 94.
Money shot.
What a way to celebrate. Congratulations, Gene the Man. You're over on Twitter. We follow you. You follow us. You got a cool YouTube channel. Congratulations, brah. Make sure to send us an email, bitethatcast@gmail.com for your information. Thanks to each and every person that participated in the contest. We're actually going to have Jamie Burko, the owner of Demso's Beat Sprites. He's going to be chilling with us here in Puerto Rico. Great friend of ours. Going to be part of the podcast. So congratulations once again. And Keith.
Yes?
I want to actually give you just 2 minutes because, you know, unfortunately, you're not coming to Puerto Rico. So you got a big couple of weeks ahead.
I do.
I'm going to miss you, brother.
I'm going to miss you, too.
You know? This is just getting sentimental now.
It's cut, so it's sad. Cutting deep. We go from money shot to deep cuts. It's an emotional roller coaster.
What about a money shot in a deep? No.
Whoa, you took it there and I didn't. That's all you, baby girl. That's all you.
Clean tag. But yeah, anything you want to say before we close out the show, man?
Yes, on a public forum, I would like to congratulate you, good sir, on your upcoming marriage. I wish you all the best, all the health, and all of the wonder and money S's in the world. So, from the bottom of my heart, I am very sad I can't be there, but to you and your lovely bride, may the force be with you.
Thank you, brother. I love you. Virtual hug. I'll hug my monitor.
Yes.
Once we close out the show.
And I'll make up with my webcam. It'll be biblical.
As it always is. So thank you, brother. Mr. McNulty, the floor is yours. Do whatever you please with this moment that you have.
Alrighty, I guess I will. That's going to do it for another episode of Byte That. So as always, thank you guys for listening. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button and check out our YouTube channel, youtube.com/ByteThatCast. We got videos going up every week. Of course, you can catch the podcast in video next week as well as the week after. So, you know, normally if you're listening on iTunes or Stitcher or TuneIn Radio, do yourself a favor, at least in the next 2 weeks, to head over to the YouTube version, because that is going to be the superior version in the next 2 weeks to see us in video. It's more exciting. So we're definitely pumped about that. You know the Twitter, @ByteThatCast, as well as facebook.com/ByteThatCast. There's one thing we didn't get to today, so I'm just going to mention it real quick. CM Punk signs with the UFC. He's going to die. All right, well, that's going to do it for this week. We'll see you guys next time.